And you know, really, it's my desire tonight that as we leave, you know, we have what, like Sherry said, 19 days till Christmas, and we have this opportunity to walk with Jesus and to be lights in our community. And as we walk out these doors, you know, to have that peace that passes all understanding. And I pray that as we leave tonight, that's how we feel. Let's pray again, and then I'm going to share from God's word. Lord, again, we thank you for your great love for each and every one of us, and we thank you for coming as a baby and dying for us as a man. Lord, we thank you for the gift that you've given to us and pray that you would speak to us today, tonight, as we look at your word. We thank you for your goodness and your grace, and we just desire that peace that you promise us. In Jesus' name we ask, amen. All right, so who of you here in the last year have felt stress or anxiety, but God has been faithful and brought you through something that's been difficult? All right, now look around. Those of you who are feeling stressed and anxious, and maybe some of you with your hands raised are feeling that way, but I want you to know that God is faithful and he brings us through the most difficult circumstances, doesn't he? I love it. David writes in Psalm 37, he says, I have been young and now I am old, yet I have never seen the righteous forsaken. I'm middle-aged and I have never seen the righteous forsaken. God has been so faithful. And it seems like this time of the year is extra stress. You know, our lives are busy, aren't they? They're busy enough just without the Christmas season. And yet this time it seems like it goes on overload, doesn't it? We get so overwhelmed with all the things that we need to do. And so I just thought this title for this evening, Heavenly Peace, is just so good for us to be reminded of how we can receive peace. In Isaiah, he prophesied concerning the Messiah, the Christ that would be born. It says in Isaiah 9:6, which is up on the screen, for unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government will be upon his shoulders. Amen to that, right? And his name will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, and Prince of Peace. And also, so it was prophesied by Isaiah and then also proclaimed at the birth of Jesus by the angels in Luke 2:14. It says, glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill towards men. So we see that peace is a key promise related to the birth of Christ, not only prophesied but proclaimed, that because of the birth of Jesus, that the earth would have peace, that we can have peace. We find that Jesus is the Prince of Peace, and he offers peace on earth. Peace is translation of a Greek word, eirene, and it speaks of a state of tranquility, exempt from rage and havoc of war. I looked it up in Wikipedia, the word peace, and it says it's a state of being mentally and spiritually at peace with enough knowledge and understanding to keep oneself strong in the face of discord or stress, the opposite of being stressed or anxious. Okay, that's what Wikipedia said was the word that meant stress. I looked it up in the Bible dictionary, and it states that it's the tranquil state of soul assured of its salvation through Christ. And so fearing nothing from God and content with its earthly lot of whatever sort it is. I thought, what a contrast. The Wikipedia says it's about you and about what you do. It's about what knowledge you have, what understanding you have. But the Bible, the peace that it talks about, is something that we're given by God, and we find rest and trust in him. The word peace is used over 400 times in the Bible. So I think it's pretty important and that God really wants to give it to us. The peace that Jesus brings is different than the peace that comes from our outside circumstances, okay? You know, we all have circumstances that go around on the outside of us, and the peace that God is talking about is something that's inside. I think about peace, tranquility, relaxation. I think about being on the beach, relaxing with an iced coffee, or being in front of a fire, or we talk about coffee a lot here, huh? About, you know, taking a bath, or I don't know, water is so peaceful. In the mornings when I run by the river, and it's just so peaceful. But we know that even when we're in one of those peaceful places, we're not necessarily peaceful on the inside, are we? We can still feel anxiety and stress, even when we're trying to be at peace. We see this in... The peace that Jesus provides is something we experience on the inside and not necessarily when the circumstances are good. And we see that in the Bible when Jesus was on the boat with his disciples, and they were going across the Sea of Galilee. And it says that in Mark 4:37, it says, "And a great windstorm arose, and the waves beat into the boat so that it was already filling. But he, Jesus, was in the stern asleep on a pillow. And they awoke him and said to him, 'Teacher, do you not care that we are perishing?'" So we see that this difficult circumstance, there's a storm coming, and yet Jesus is at peace, and he's at rest, and he's sleeping. And we too can have peace inside, even though we have a storm raging around us on the outside. In Acts, there's a beautiful picture of Paul and Silas. They had been beaten and cast in the darkness of the prison. Yet in the midst of their trial, it says in Acts 16:25, that at midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns to God, and the prisoners were listening to them. And so they were worshiping the Lord. They were in the most difficult circumstances, being in prison, had been beaten, and yet they found that they could worship and praise the Lord because they had that peace that was in their heart. And I love this because it says, and the prisoners were listening. And it's worth noting that people are looking at us, don't they, when we're suffering, when we're going through difficulty, and they're looking at us to see how we're going to respond. And it's such a great opportunity when difficulties arise, when we have that peace of the Lord, that we become witnesses to others. And it says in the book of Acts that their actions led to a whole family getting saved because they couldn't believe that they were worshiping God when they were in such difficult circumstances. We need to keep that in mind, that it is not our circumstances that determine our peace. Do you know that? It's not our circumstances that determine our peace. But don't be misled. Just because we're sleeping in the storm doesn't necessarily we have peace, does it? I think of Jonah when he had heard from God, he had ran from God, and he went to sleep in the boat when the storm hit. And it wasn't because he was at peace, but it was out of depression and anxiety, wasn't it? He was trying to forget about his problems and get his mind, at sleep mode where he didn't have to think about it. So not necessarily if you're sleeping do you have the peace of the Lord. Jesus said in John 14:27, do I have that? "Peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. Not as the world gives do I give to you. Let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid." He gives us a peace that the world does not know, that the world cannot understand. The world allows the circumstances around them to dictate how they respond and how they feel on the inside. But God says, Jesus says, "I want to give you a peace that passes all understanding, and no matter what your difficulty is, that you can have rest and find peace in me." And Jesus wants to give us peace that is greater than any circumstance we face. And tonight I wanted to look at what sort of peace that Jesus provides for us. And in his birth, Jesus first provides us peace with God. And we see that in Romans 5:1, it states, "Therefore, having been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ." And then in Ephesians 2:13, it says, "But now in Christ Jesus, you who once were afar off have been brought near by the blood of Christ. For he himself is our peace." Jesus is our peace, who has made both one and has broken down the middle wall of separation. Jesus was born for this purpose. He was born to make us to be able to have a relationship with God. God, a holy God, who was removed from us because of our sin. Our sinfulness kept us from God. Jesus came and was born so that he could grow up and to die on the cross for our sins. And this is the whole reason why he was born. When I was in high school, I was in a psychology class, and for some reason, I don't even remember what the reasoning was, but it was the day before Christmas break, and the teacher brought us down to the theater at school, and she said, "We're going to have like a talent show, and you guys can just get up and do whatever you want." I don't know, kind of scary in high school for let people do that, but I was a Christian then, and I thought, oh my goodness, this is my opportunity. I'm going to get up there on the stage, and I'm going to share Jesus with these people. And so I went, and I told the story, and I talked about how Jesus was born so that he can grow up and die on the cross for our sins. And afterwards, a girl came up to me and she goes, "I think you're confused about what holiday this is. This is Christmas, not Easter." But I'm not confused. This is the purpose for why he was born. In Galatians 4, chapter 4, verse 4, it says, "But when the fullness of the time had come, God sent forth his son, born of a woman, born under the law, to redeem those who were under the law, that we might receive the adoptions as daughters." And so it says, when the fullness of time had come, that means in his perfect timing. You know, the Old Testament prophesies about how the Messiah was going to come. He was going to be born in Bethlehem. He was going to live in Nazareth. He was going to die for our sins. You know, it prophesied about this. And it says, in God's perfect timing, that baby was born. When all things were perfect, God sent his son so that he could be born, so that he could die on the cross. We were separated from God because of our sin, and Jesus came into the world to pay the penalty for our sin. Our sin, our guilt, was placed upon him on the cross. You know, we don't deserve to go to heaven, but because of what Jesus did, he bore our sin on his shoulders so that we could be in heaven with the Lord. We're all familiar with John 3:16. It says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life." And so we know that it's not on our own merit, but it's because of what Jesus did. And that baby being born in the manger was the one who was going to atone for our sins. And so we have that peace with God because of what Jesus did. But not only that, that would be enough, wouldn't it, to have peace with God because of what Jesus did? But not only that, it says that we can have peace here and now in this world. And that takes a lot, doesn't it? This world is so crazy and chaotic. And if we spend 5 minutes on watching the news, you know, it becomes so overwhelming. On my phone, I have an iPhone. I have an AP mobile that American Press, that it blinks at me or pops up at me when something traumatic happens in the world. And this is what I say now, whenever I hear the noise, I go, "Oh, who died now?" Because that's exactly what it is. I mean, it's just so overwhelming sometimes when we look at the world, and there's no peace in the world, is there? But Jesus came that we can have peace. In Isaiah 26:3, I love this verse. It's going to be on the it says, "You will keep him in perfect peace whose mind is stayed on you because he trusts you." Isn't that beautiful? He keeps us in perfect peace when our minds are stayed on him. First, in order to have our minds stayed upon him, we must abide in Christ. In Galatians 5:22, it tells us that peace is a fruit of the Spirit. And it says that love, joy, peace, patience, and peace is one of those fruits of the Spirit. The Spirit wants to give us the peace. Fruit can be defined as the effect or consequence of an action or operation. It's a natural byproduct of a healthy tree. Jesus says in John 15, I am the vine, you are the branches. He who abides in me and I in him will bear much fruit. So that's how we bear the fruit. Jesus is the vine, we are the branches. As we abide in him, then we bear fruit. That word abide means to stay, to stand firm, and to dwell. Those who stay, seek, and spend time with Jesus will bear fruit in their lives. In Psalm 1, it says, those who meditate on God's word will be like a tree planted by rivers of waters that will bring forth fruit and will not wither. Those who meditate on God's word, those who are looking to God's word and to seek him through his word, we will become fruit-bearing trees, will be healthy and bear fruit. God's word plants a seed in our heart that bears fruit in our lives. Have you noticed that? As you take in God's word, it literally transforms us from the inside out. His word is alive and powerful and able to do a work in us that we cannot do in ourselves. We cannot muster up peace within ourselves. Amusement means to get our minds off of something. So we can go to an amusement park and we can get our mind off our problems, but it doesn't really change our problems and it doesn't give us peace. In Psalm 119, verse 165, it says, great peace have those who love your law. We have to know Jesus and abide in Jesus and spend time with Jesus in order to get to know him, because we need to be able to trust him. We have peace. Remember that verse in Isaiah 26, it says, to those who trust him. Trust can be defined as confidence or reliance. Trusting in the Lord is the key to our peace, isn't it? Trust is resting our minds on the integrity or sound principles of another. So we rest upon him because we know him. We have to get to know him through his word. And as we get to know him, we trust him because we see that he's faithful. I think about children when they're young. My kids, they would always like jump off of anything for me to catch them. You know, whether you're prepared or not, they were jumping. Like I remember walking away from them and them jumping on my back. And that's how much they trust us, right? They think, well, we'll never drop them. But Shane, I see him back there, I did drop him once, but don't tell him. He was only about 6 months old. I don't think he remembers. But I tried to be as trustworthy as possible. But even us as parents are not always trustworthy. But God is always trustworthy, and he will never drop us. In Jeremiah chapter 17, I love this verse. It's verses 5 through 8. It says, cursed is the man who trusts in man and makes flesh his strength, whose heart departs from the Lord. For he shall be like a shrub in the desert and shall not see when good comes, but shall inhabit the parched places in the wilderness, in a salt land which is not inhabited. He says, cursed is the man who trusts in men. Why? Because men are not trustworthy. Why? We disappoint one another. As friends, as family, we cannot fulfill, we cannot satisfy one another, and so we disappoint one another. And it says, and God says, don't trust in men, because the verse that I love, it says, they shall not see even when good comes. I mean, sometimes when you're trusting in people and you're disappointed and something good happens, you can't even see it because you're so engulfed in the problems that are around you. But it goes on to say, blessed is the man who trusts in the Lord and whose hope is in the Lord. For she shall be like a tree planted by the waters, which spread out its roots by the river, and will not fear when heat comes, but its leaf will be green and will not be anxious in the year of drought, nor will cease from yielding food. And I love that. If you trust in the Lord and you're feeding on the Lord, it's like a tree by a river of water that just is growing and healthy. And even when drought or difficulties come, you're still bearing fruit because you've taken in from the things of God. And so it's such a beautiful picture. Would you rather be a shrub or a fruit-bearing tree? We get a choice. Are we going to trust in the Lord and see him be faithful? Or are we going to continue trusting him in, or even trusting in ourselves? I think a lot of times we think we can handle the problems. We need to put our confidence in the Lord. If we put our confidence in others, at the exception of God, we will be disappointed, and we won't see when good comes. If you choose to trust in him, you will find that he is trustworthy. And I have seen in my greatest difficulties that God's peace is more evident than ever before. And haven't you seen that? In the greatest difficulty, we see that God is so faithful. And I wanted to share a story about 9 years ago when my son James, it's so awkward because I like have one. Could you scoot over just so I don't see you? My son James, when he was nine, we were on vacation in California. And we had a whirlwind trip. We had gone to Hawaii for a week, and then we went up to the mountains with my sister to go wakeboarding. And we'd just been up there for a couple days, and we were wakeboarding on the boat. And after we were done, James had fallen asleep on the boat, and we got him up, and he was acting really, like, super groggy. And we thought, this is really weird, and we were trying to get the wetsuit off of him, and it was really hard. And I told him to put his sandals on, and he couldn't get his sandal on. I'm like, what are you doing? And he couldn't get his words out. They weren't coming out. I'm like, stop messing around. Get your shoes on. You know, I'm so mean, aren't I? Sorry. So then he like felt overwhelmed, you could tell, and he started laughing, but that real anxious laugh, and his side of his mouth was drooping, and I realized like half of his body was not responding to him. And I'm like, Jim, it looks like he's having a stroke. And you know, I never knew of a child who had a stroke. And so we took care of him. We took him to a close emergency room, and they couldn't deal with thinking that he may have had a stroke or whatever, a head injury. You know, we had been wakeboarding, so then we were thinking, well, maybe he hit his head while he was wakeboarding. I don't know. So we end up taking him to another hospital, and he did, in fact, he stopped breathing. They had to intubate him. They took him through getting CAT scans and MRI and echocardiogram and all this stuff. They had put him to sleep. But you know, we're standing there in the emergency room, and they're intubating him and putting him to sleep, and they had let him go for over a minute without breathing, and would wake him up, and he'd go, you know, so his own body reflexes were not working, and so they had to take him away to run all these tests, and they just left us there standing, and you think, this may be the last time I will see my son. I don't know what's going on. And so Jim and I, we walked to the car, and we just started crying and praying. And I tell you, I have never experienced the peace of God like I did at that moment. It like flooded down into the car, and we just had peace. And I didn't know whether he was going to live. It wasn't that sort of peace. It was just peace that God was in control. And I find that in those very difficult circumstances that God shows up and he gives us that peace, and he's here and he's healthy, and God is so faithful and so good. But we experience that. But you know, sometimes it's not the big problems that we don't have peace, we don't receive the peace. It's those little things, isn't it? We pile on all these little problems. We try, it's usually those things that we think we can handle, that we load up on our back, that keeps us all so burdened down and so overwhelmed. But God wants to give us peace in those times as well. He can handle those difficulties. I looked up that word anxiety. It's distress or uneasiness of mind caused by fear, danger, or misfortune. I was thinking, you know, really, anxiety is fear of things that haven't actually happened, huh? We worry the most about things that we think might happen. And I love it. The Bible says that don't worry about today, because tomorrow has enough problems, and God's going to give you strength for today. And so we want to give those things to the Lord. Are you struggling financially? This time of the year is particularly difficult. We face pressure to give gifts, you know, maybe spend more money than we have. We give gifts out of guilt because somebody else gives us something. Instead of getting caught up in spending, we want to trust God to meet our needs. In Matthew 6:31, it says, "Don't worry about your life, what you will eat, drink, or wear, for your heavenly Father knows that you have need of these things." And it's not that we need to go out and spend money and trust that God's going to provide. He wants to bless us and provide for us. And even like looking at these inexpensive things we can do, you know, we can do nice, thoughtful things for people. I heard once a Bible study, a woman sharing, and I just loved it. She said, you know, I want to give gifts that mean something to people. And so I pray and I ask the Lord, you know, to show me what I can do for them, what I can give to them. And the Lord's always faithful to give me wisdom. You know, he has wisdom, and give us wisdom to do things or to care for someone. A lot of times people just like to be thought of and to have time spent with them, and it doesn't have to be about money. And God just wants us to rest in him. We're going to trust in him. It's common for the issues of life to give us anxiety. You know, I think about, we get too busy, our house gets messy, we get stressed out at the kids, or work is hard, or whatever it may be, and these things just pile on us, and we feel overwhelmed, and then we don't have peace in our life, and we're spreading the anxiety and fear around us. You know, it's easy for us to yell at our kids because we're overwhelmed. And that's not how the Lord wants us to walk. He wants us to walk in the Spirit and have that peace that we can be a light to those around us. In Philippians 4, verse 6 and 7, it says, "Be anxious for nothing." What is that? For nothing. "But in everything, by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God." He wants to hear from us. The next verse says, "And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus." Anxiety is a new thing, isn't it? It's an epidemic that's going on. I looked it up. It said that $11 billion dollars is spent every year in the U.S. for anxiety medicine. Okay, that's a lot of money. Think of what we could do with all that money. But I would say that the world is very anxious. And the Bible tells us that we as Christians are to be anxious for nothing. We're to give it to the Lord. How do we do this? We pray and we leave it at the Lord's feet. Remember, to have peace, you have to trust in Jesus. But we have to know Jesus in order to trust in him. We need to be in God's word and to see who he really is, how much he loves us. He loves us so much, and he wants to give us that peace and that rest that the world does not know, the world does not understand. In Matthew 11:28, Jesus says, "Come to me, all you who labor and are heavy laden and overburdened, and I will give you rest. I will ease and relieve and refresh your soul." I don't know about you, but I tend to run away from people like that, that are heavy laden and burdened. But Jesus says, come to me and I will give you rest. He wants to take that burden that you carry. He wants you to lay it down at his feet and leave it there. And he wants to give you rest. Recently, I was my friend who has cancer, she writes a blog periodically, and I read it this week, and I loved it. She's been dealing with cancer for a year, and she's single, and I know it's been very difficult, and she was saying just how difficult it is, but she wrote on the blog that she said that she writes a to-do list for the Lord, and she writes the things that she cannot take care of, which are really most everything, right? We cannot control anything. Have you noticed that? I mean, I try to get my kids to clean their room. They don't do anything. They tell me they clean their room, and then I walk up there. They're both like, whoop. All right. But I walk upstairs, and it is a disaster. And you know there's that scripture in the Bible where you ask someone to do something, and they don't do it, and they say they will, and they don't do it, but then you ask somebody else to do it, and they say no, but they end up doing it. I would rather have that one, the one that says no, but ends up doing it, but I have all the ones that say they did it, and they didn't do it. But anyways, I love that. To write, I mean, isn't it good? It's good for us to write things down, and we write a to-do list. Lord, these are the things that you need to take care of. And you write those things that are causing you anxiety, are stealing your peace, down on a piece of paper and say, Lord, this is yours. You're going to take care of it. And he is faithful to take care of those things that causes us anxiety and fear and worry. In that Philippians verse, it says that the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds. The peace that we receive from him is just that peace. It guards our mind and our hearts, and it lets us find rest in him. And so the world cannot understand this. And Jesus, every time we start to worry or fret, we need to give it back to the Lord. Lord, this is yours. This is what you can take care of. Please, Lord, take care of it, and he will. We have seen that we can have peace with God and peace from God, right? We have peace with God because of what Jesus has done, and we have peace from God because of what Jesus has done. But also, we have another aspect that we can give that peace to the world. We have Jesus that lives in us, and we can go out into the world and we can share that peace with others. And I just think, especially this time of the year, what an awesome opportunity we have to share the love of Jesus to everybody we meet in the stores we're at. I mean, people are so overwhelmed and anxious with their things, and we can be gracious and kind. You know, I think about being cut off, you know, in a grocery line or being cut off in a parking spot or whatever it may be, and we can just say, oh, praise the Lord, you know, and be a light shining, and don't get angry and upset. I really, when I lived in California, which was a long time ago, but I would be so overwhelmed and anxious and get, when I went to Costco, it just seemed so overwhelming because there were so many people there and the line was so long. And then we moved here, and I really didn't have anything to do. And I had four little babies that I would take everywhere with me. I'd never been to Walmart before. That was pretty amazing. I could get their haircut, get pictures developed, get the tires changed on the car, and grocery shop all in one stop. And we'd spend all day at Walmart. It seemed so fun. But you know, I just realized how busy I had made my life and how simple it really could be. And when you make your life simple, when you remove things or you're not in a hurry, you can time yourself better, you can really show God's love to people. I remember being at Sam's Club and a lady was ringing me up so slow and I was so irritated with her. And then she said, oh, my back is just hurting so bad. I think it's so funny that the cashiers complain all the time. But anyways, it gives us a great opportunity to pray with them, doesn't it? And I said, you know what, can I pray with you? And she was so elated. And you know, it changes our perspective, it changes their perspective, and it gives us an opportunity to be those lights that Jesus wants us to be. In Matthew 5, Jesus says, I think it's on the, blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called daughters of God, right? He wants us to be peacemakers. And we're, Jesus is the peacemaker. He's the one that's brought peace between God and man, and he gives us his peace. And we're to bear the resemblance and the character of Jesus. I was thinking about years ago, I was at the Brevard Zoo. I think my twins were like 4 years old, and somebody came up to me and goes, are those Jim Gallagher's sons? I'm like, yeah. And he says, oh, I go to Calvary Merritt Island. Your husband has taught there, and they look just like him. Is that weird? I'm like, he must have seen something. That is just too weird. But we're supposed to resemble Jesus. And we have this amazing opportunity. People will say, are you Jesus' daughter? You look just like him. You know, wouldn't that be awesome to be able to resemble him in that way? In 2 Corinthians 5:19, it says that we are given the message of reconciliation to the world. That reconcile is to restore relationship between two parties. We have Jesus, and we are in the world, but we're not of the world. And we reconcile these two together. We get this opportunity to grab people by the hand and to bring them to Jesus, because we know there is life in Jesus. There is no life in this world. People are looking for life, and they are not finding it. That's why there's $11 billion, for anxiety medicine, is because people are not finding happiness. We live in a world, in America, we live in a land that promises us the pursuit of happiness. And I can tell you that people have been pursuing it and have not been finding it, because they've been looking in the wrong place. They're looking at the world to satisfy them and not to Jesus. But we have this opportunity to be lights and to share Jesus with people, and they too can have that peace. It is really such an amazing time of the year. I love this time of year. I love that we can go into the stores and we hear the music singing about Jesus, you know. And so I just want to encourage you that as we walk out these doors, to be in that mindset, to know that we have peace in Jesus, that we are the light of the world, that he has given us that, the message of reconciliation, and so we can go into the world and we can share that. And just, we have 19 days to spread the light around, to share Jesus with people. We have an amazing opportunity here at the PAC on December 24th on Christmas Eve. That is, will be an amazing evening where the gospel will be shared, and we get an opportunity, we can invite people to that. We can be praying for people. We can be showing Jesus' love and his peace and his light as we go around. And I just hope that as we leave, that we're encouraged and we have the right frame of mind. We don't have to be frazzled. We don't have to be overwhelmed. We can spend that time with Jesus, get our morning started with Jesus, so that we can go out and be lights into the world. So let's close our eyes and bow our heads. Lord, we thank you for the peace that you give us, Lord. Not only do we have peace with God, but we have peace within, and we get to share that peace without. It's so amazing to me, really knowing who you are and the peace that you really do give. And I just want to ask if there's anybody here tonight that has not received Jesus or does not know that peace, that you would just raise your hand. Is there anybody here that wants that peace that Jesus gives? And then also, if there's, we'll pray, thank you, Lord. Jesus, I pray for those who raise their hand. We thank you, Lord, that you love these women so much, that you have a plan and a purpose, and we pray that you would come into their life and give them that peace that you promise. We thank you, Jesus, ask that you would forgive the sins and that you would birth in them that new life that you promise. And also, if there's anybody here that is a Christian but just is feeling overwhelmed, anxious, that you would raise your hand and let me just pray with you. Lord, and for these that have their hands raised, I know, Lord, we live in such a crazy society. Life is so busy and so overwhelming, and we have so many circumstances that want to just beat us down. But I know, Lord, that in the midst of those difficulties, Lord, you want to minister, and I pray for these women that you would give them the peace that passes all understanding, that you would that they would give that burden to you, that they would be able to lay it at the foot of the cross and trust, Jesus, that you're going to take care of them and that they would find that inner peace. We thank you, Lord. Thank you for your goodness and your mercy. We want to be used by you, Lord. We pray that we would be lights in this town this season, that people would be amazed, that we would be asked what is different about us, and we would get opportunity to share with others, Lord. We thank you. Thank you for your greatness. Thank you, Jesus, for coming and dying for us that we might live and have abundant life. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, Kimberly's going to share one more song with us.